Harper and Harper Audio present Rise of the School for Good and Evil by Soman Chainani, performed by Kit Young. The pen writes the new schoolmaster's name. But this time, it doesn't write one name. It writes two. The pen is called the Storian. Long and steel, sharp at both ends. It floats into the air over the two boys, its tip like an eye. Then it speaks. The voice warm and ageless, neither male nor female. In exchange for immortality, in exchange for eternal youth, I choose you, two brothers, one for good, one for evil. Your loyalty to your blood greater than the loyalty to your side. As long as you love each other, the world stays in balance. Good and evil, brother and brother. But every schoolmaster faces a test. Yours is love. Betray that love and the test is failed. You will wither and die. You will be replaced. Raise your hands to seal this oath. The boys do. Twins who wear the same face. Rian, skin golden, hair wild, lifts his hand. The pen glows hot and slashes his palm, Rian crying out. Then Rafal, skin milky white, hair like silver spikes. It stabs his hand and Rafal doesn't flinch. The pen's glow fades, its steel growing cold. The twins glance at each other, burning with questions. But in the end, they ask only one. What happened to the last schoolmaster? The pen doesn't answer. Instead, a trembling voice rises from the shadows, a withered old man.
I failed, he says.
Part 1. Bad Magic. 1. If not for a boy named Aladdin, the School for Good and Evil might never have started kidnapping readers like you. You'd be safe in your beds, instead of stolen to a world where fairy tales come true for some and end in death for others. But Aladdin is where the tale starts. The tale of what happened between the schoolmasters, two brothers, good and evil, who ruled the legendary school. But Aladdin hasn't the faintest clue he's part of a larger story. He's too busy thinking about his magic lamp. He should have been working at his family's tailoring shop, but, like usual, he'd slipped away the moment his father turned his back, bounding off to Mahaba Market on the hunt for good fortune. Mahaba sparked him to life. The smells, the sounds, the girls. And an hour there was worth 1,000 days in his family shop. He knew he should work in the shop, of course, that a good boy would do as he's told. But tailors don't marry the Sultan's daughter, and that's what he dreamed of. A princess, and a crown, and the respect of the people. The kind of respect that no one gave him.
Good morning, Raja. Busier than usual today. Aladdin greeted the fruit seller.
Raja gave him a dirty look.
Lovely day, Shilpa. Look at all the crowds, Aladdin said to the fish vendor.
Shilpa spat in his direction.
Shall we play a game of dice, Basu?
Aladdin asked a skinny man at the corner.
Basu fled.
Aladdin sighed, his hands in the pockets of his ragged blue jacket. He had a reputation as a thief, cheat, and loiterer. But what choice did he have? He had no money, status, or name in this world. And to earn those things, sometimes you have to take shortcuts. and today was the perfect day for action. The market bustling like it was a holiday, full of kids with parents fussing over them, buying their favorite treats. Aladdin had never seen Mahubba like this, not even at New Year. That's when he heard two men talking in an alley as he passed, two men he knew well, Salim and Asim.
"It's the magic lamp," Salim was saying.
"How did you get it?" asked Asim.
"The Sultan found the Cave of Wishes, but his caravan was robbed by thieves on the way back to the palace," Salim confided.
"The thieves didn't know it was the treasured lamp and sold it right to me."
"Make your 3 wishes then," said Asim.
Aladdin's ears perked up. The magic lamp had been the source of legend for thousands of years, but no one had ever found it. And now these two goons had it in their hands.
"A likely story," Aladdin said, turning into the alley.
Salim instantly put the lamp away.
"I already saw it. No doubt a fake," Aladdin scoffed, puffing at his mop of black hair. "But go ahead. Prove it's the magic lamp. Prove it has any value at all."
Salim and Asim peeked at each other. Then Salim held up the lamp and rubbed it with his palm. Suddenly, the lamp glowed and thick red smoke billowed from its tip, before Salim stoppered it with his finger and the lamp went dull once more.
"Don't want to set the genie loose here, or we'll all get put in the Sultan's jail," Salim warned.
Aladdin's eyes flared. The lamp was real? He rushed forward.
"Sell it to me."
Salim laughed.
"It's not for sale, you fool."
"Everything in this world is for sale," Aladdin insisted.
"Not this," Asim scorned. "Not to a rat who cheats me and Salim out of our hard-earned money."
"A rat who was a worthless stain on his family," Salim added.
Aladdin smiled through his teeth. They could insult him all they wanted. In a negotiation, whoever wants something more wins. And Aladdin didn't just want the lamp. He needed it. Imagine the princess he could wish for. Imagine the man he could be, finally worthy of respect.
"I'll roll you my dice for it," Aladdin insisted. "If I win, I keep the lamp. If you win, I'll pay you back everything I've ever taken from you, and I'll never step foot in Mahubba Market again."
He assumed the two men would mock this offer, since he hardly had enough for lunch, let alone a chest of savings lying around. But to Aladdin's surprise, Salim and Asim flashed each other mysterious looks.
"Hmm," said Salim. "He's cheated enough from us that if he pays us back, we can each buy a house near Bahim Beach.
Plus the thought of never seeing his dirty, rotten face again," said Asim.
The two men turned to Aladdin.
"We have a deal."
"We do?"
Aladdin said, stunned.
"Over 6, you win. Under 6, we win," said Asim.
Aladdin knew better than to waste more words. In his left pocket, he had dice carved to land over 6. In his right pocket, he had dice carved to land under. He drew the ones from his left pocket and threw them down in the grimy street.
"I win," Aladdin gloated, holding out his palm. "Give me the lamp."
"You cheated," Salim protested.
"A deal's a deal," Aladdin said firmly.
The two men glanced at each other. With a heavy sigh, Salim handed over the lamp. Aladdin whistled as he walked away, stuffing his treasure under his jacket. He couldn't see the grins spreading across the faces of the two men he'd just beaten. 2. There were wishes to be made. A princess bride, a sultan's crown, his name remembered forever. But first, he had to clean toilets. That was the price for skipping work, which was better than no supper,
the punishment his mother had decreed for a few nights, before she realized he would happily starve and die instead of toil in a shop. So she had to try something else.
What good are you?
She bellowed from the kitchen as he scrubbed the bathroom. But Aladdin was too full of her chicken stew and sour cherry rice to be bothered. He'd stuffed the lamp under his bed when he came home. As soon as his parents were asleep, he would take it to the garden and make his first wish, because it didn't seem wise to unleash a genie in the house with such thin walls. His mother raised her voice.
Hagrafa's son will surely get taken to the school for good and become famous and rich, and here my son is, stealing pani puri and cheating people in Mahaba Market. You think I don't know? Everyone knows.
Aladdin stiffened. He'd forgotten it was kidnapping night. He glanced out the window at the row of houses down the lane, plates of halva and honey biscuits laid out on the windowsills to entice the schoolmaster. No wonder it had been so crowded in the market. All those mothers and fathers bringing their children to Mahaba, thinking and hoping that it would be their last day together. That tonight, the schoolmaster would come and whisk their sons and daughters to the place where legends are born. After all, if a child was taken as an ever or a never, their parents would be celebrated in Shazaba, invited to the poshest parties, offered the best table at Giti's restaurant, even sent flowers by the Sultan himself. Of course, most children taken from Shazaba were for the good school, since Shazaba was one of the ever kingdoms in the Endless Woods. But over the years, there had been a handful of nevers taken too, since regardless of whether a kingdom labeled itself good or evil, rogue spirits always slipped through. Not that any of this applied to Aladdin. He was selfish, thieving, but he wasn't evil, not down to his core like the souls the schoolmaster wanted. Remember that stray dog he'd shared his pistachio tart with? Yes, the tart was stolen, but who cares? Or that girl at the schoolhouse that he'd helped with her homework? Her being pretty had nothing to do with it. Then again, he wasn't good either. Even his parents would agree. The good school was for other kids. Ones born to clearer paths. Ones who didn't struggle like him to find their way. But at last that struggle had been rewarded. He didn't need to go to the school for good and evil to achieve his dreams. He had the lamp now. The magic lamp. That would give him more riches and power than the schoolmasters themselves. Finally, people would pay attention to him. People would know his name. But how to make the lamp work? Salim had just rubbed it, hadn't he? Or was there a magic word? He'd sort it out. First, he needed to finish his cleaning and pretend to sleep before his father came home. Otherwise, it would be an hour of lectures. Downstairs, the door swung open.
Aladdin!
A voice boomed. The boy slumped. It wouldn't have been so bad if his father hadn't plopped down on Aladdin's bed, right where the lamp was stuffed under the mattress, and his dad was so large that the boy worried the lamp would get crushed along with the genie inside.
What is it you're searching for, Aladdin?
His dad started, still sweating from his trip up the stairs.
What is it that takes you so far away from my shop?
Aladdin imagined he and a beautiful princess living in a palace 1,000 times the size of this house, with locks on every door, so no one could enter without his permission. A palace he'd wished to life once his dad left his room.
Aladdin?
Hmm? The boy said. His father gazed hard at him.
I think you don't want to work in my shop because you think that you can do better, that you will be a big shot who will live in a castle and marry a king's daughter instead of working humbly like the rest of us. You go chasing after phantoms when you have a perfectly good life in front of you. That never ends well. Anyone who knows the Storian's tales can tell you. You don't believe in me,
Aladdin thought.
You think I can't win a girl like that and make something of myself. You and Mom think I'm worthless, just like Salim said.
But he didn't voice any of these things. Instead, he yawned.
Yes, Dad.
So, tomorrow I'll see you bright and early in the shop?
Yes, Dad.
Good boy.
He gave Aladdin a hug, then closed the door behind him, and the boy promptly pulled the lamp from beneath the mattress.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.